Good morning, everyone. Welcome, and thank you for being here. It's a delight to see all of you here. I'm Stuart Sims, and I'm Speaker of the Faculty, and it's my pleasure on behalf of the Academic Senate to welcome you to our Fall Convocation. I'm delighted to welcome you to our Fall Convocation, where we've gathered to mark the start of our collaboration, our significant work together for the 2016-2017 academic year. All of us, faculty, staff, administrators, service and support workers of all kinds, contribute to the success of our university in important and indispensable ways. It takes all of us, it takes the work of all of us together to be sure that our success not only sustains, but grows. That sounds cliche, I know. My inner cynic actually laughed when I first wrote that last bit. I did, I laughed out loud at myself. It takes the work of all of us together to be sure that our success not only sustains, but grows. I thought that's a pull quote for the webpage right there. I have to admit that I really struggled as I sketched these remarks because this stuff is hard to talk about without sounding cliche or boilerplate or routine, because it's so obvious and so clearly essential that standing up here this morning and pointing out to you that your work is valuable to the rest of us and that our work together is valuable to our students and to the rest of everyone around us, really, is sort of like pointing out that water is wet, or gravity is heavy, or, to quote Steve Martin, that a day without sunshine is like, you know, night. Right? Saw a couple people knew the punchline to that before I got to it. Some Steve Martin fans. So I found my tone pinging between philosopher and motivational speaker, which is not a good place to be for those of you who have to write public remarks. Between wanting to really talk lofty about how important a university is, about how important this university is to this region and its people, on one hand, and on the other hand, to talk about how it's our collaborative work that makes our university happen, literally day after day, how every aspect of our work is essential to our collective success. I'm hoping in these remarks to renew a sense of purpose by reminding us of the scale and significance of our ongoing endeavors here. And at the same time, I want to fire everybody up by talking about how many people we affect, how many students we serve in ways large and small, how many lives we change. I got kind of stuck because I wasn't sure how to connect those in a meaningful way and communicate them in a sincere way without sounding trite. And then I remembered a quote from a writer long dear to me, the hilarious and wickedly smart Douglas Adams. Who said this about human nature? Human beings who are almost unique in having the ability to learn from the experience of others are also remarkable for their apparent disinclination to do so. All of us have done this, and we all do this, because it really is something about how human beings are. That's why some of you laugh, at least I assume. What's really remarkable is that we all come together today and every workday to collaborate on this giant ongoing project called the university, to work for our students and our community, and to counter that very human tendency to avoid the hard work of learning and growth. It's what all of our efforts, large and small, are part of. So at the risk of tipping over into motivational poster territory, I'll conclude by repeating myself, because it's simply true and it's fundamentally important. All of us contribute to the success of this university in important and indispensable ways. And it takes the work of all of us together to be sure that our success not only sustains, but grows, because our work here matters. Thank you. For additional remarks, I'm pleased to introduce a current Stanislaus State student who serves in a variety of important roles on campus and whose hard work demonstrates her commitment to advocating, her sincere commitment for advocating for and advancing student needs and concerns. Please join me in welcoming ASI President Nicole Larson.
Good morning. That was good. That was like a good response. I wasn't expecting that. Wow. You guys are awake. It's awesome. Thank you for joining me as we gather to hear what our leadership envisions, values, and believes in. The specific campus is full of faculty, staff, students, and community members that will be a part of the process of putting Stan State on the map. As our prestigious, well-deserved recognitions grow, so do our freshman classes. Our university is so unique because we are able to offer a prominent education while providing a safe, affordable, and intimate college experience for our student body. And this student body consists of first-generation students, Pell-eligible students, and some students who at some point didn't even think college was an option for them. In this last week, we have been recognized by Washington Monthly for the quality of our education we can provide students, with the most resources per dollar we can offer. This seems to be a constant theme in most of the honors that we receive and earn. This isn't simply a result of a fairly new university working its way up in the Central Valley. It's a promise that our leadership of our university has made to capitalize with the resources we have to equip the next generations like me to reinvent, reinvest, and represent what Stan State, what Turlock, and what the Central Valley has to offer to the region. We have great momentum right now. Our university is growing and ready to take on the challenges and accomplishments that come with the potential that our university has. The great strides we have made in the last 10 years here at Stan State has brought us to the level of greatness with the lingering possibility of stagnation. However, with President Junn's experience and vision, I am confident that we will continue to make great strides. Stan State is not only going to be looking to be leaders in academics, but in our surrounding community, in the region. This is something that calls for great leadership, and great leadership is something that we have. Being a member of the Presidential Search Committee, there are so many achievements on President Junn's resume that are extremely impressive. If I were to go over each one, we would have to be here for a much longer time than an hour, and I would be up here much longer than President Junn talking herself. I'm sure all of you will be just as impressed and touched as we were on the Presidential Search Committee by President Junn's forward-thinking, no-nonsense style, and authentic care and understanding for what we are here at Stan State. And I'm so happy to welcome her into our family. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole. Next, I'm honored to introduce our host for this convocation. Truly honored and excited. A dynamic and substantial addition to our ensemble here at Stanislaus State, our new president. Dr. Ellen Junn joins our campus after over 30 years in teaching and leadership positions at 5 California State University campuses, where she displayed a gift for helping non-traditional students succeed. One of the many qualities that will serve her well, we hope, is the 11th president of California State University, Stanislaus. Junn, who most recently served as the provost and vice president for academic affairs at CSU Dominguez Hills, has also served as the chief academic officer at San Jose State, as associate provost at Fresno State, and held various leadership positions at Cal State Fullerton. No, Nicole said it would take a hold the rest of the hour to read out her CV, so I'm trying to give you the very condensed version of the bullet points because it is a lot of stuff. She said she relishes her return to the Central Valley for several reasons. Most notably, that she sees the region as on the cusp of becoming an economic powerhouse, with Stan State in position to be an exciting catalyst for change. That's a vision I can get behind. Junn is widely published and has written professional journal articles on topics such as supporting the success of underserved students, the importance of university community engagement, and strategies for supporting non-tenure-track faculty, especially women and minorities. She holds a bachelor's degree in experimental and cognitive psychology from the University of Michigan, where she graduated cum laude. She earned both a master's and PhD in cognitive and developmental psychology from Princeton University, In addition, she holds a Management Development Program certificate from Harvard University. Her husband, Dr. Alan Greenberg, arrived with her in Turlock, and her son is a doctoral student studying history at Columbia University. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ellen Junn, the 11th president of Stanislaus State.
Good morning, everyone. It's so exciting to be here on this convocation day for this fall 2016. And I wanted to first start by saying welcome to everyone who came out this morning. And I really hope that you will participate, and we'll talk about that in a moment. But I wanted to especially welcome everyone here, whether you're a student, a faculty member, staff, department chairs, deans, directors, vice presidents, community members, and elected and other officials. And on behalf of the elected officials, there are a number of them who've joined us here this morning, so I would like to give them special recognition by stating who they are. Some of them might still be in the parking lot trying to find a place to park, so let's see how we go here. So if you're an elected official, please stand, and if you could hold your applause, we'll applaud everyone at the end. Paul Zeke, Chief of Staff for Assemblymember Kristen Olson. Is Paul here? There's Paul. Thank you, Paul. Vito, supervisor for Stanislaus County. Vito, yes, there's Vito. Bravo. Gary Soyseth, the mayor of City of Turlock. Excellent. Gary Hampton, the city manager of Turlock. And Cecil Russell, CEO, Modesto Chamber of Commerce. Dana Trevithan, superintendent, Turlock Unified School District. There she is. Excellent. And Adrian Harold, Chair of the Stanislaus State Alumni Council and owner of New Bridge Management. Please give all of these officials a big round of applause. But we also have media here as well, and they'll be taking questions with me around the noon time hour. So the agenda for today is a very short, we only have until noon, so I hope to stay within that timeline, but I have much to share with you. And so here's just an overview of what I'd like to cover in the remaining 50 minutes or so, 40 minutes with question and answer at the end. We've done a welcome. Now I wanted to give you a little bit of update on the president's, on my activities with the campus and some of the accomplishments, both that have occurred and that will be occurring, and then talk a little bit about possible future directions, a lot of focus on collaboration and communication with all kinds of constituencies across the campus and in our region and our communities, and then we'll want to round up with a little Q&A. All right, so now normally when you go to a performance, the first thing they tell you is silence your phone, which is true. I want you to silence your phone, but I want you to take them out because we're going to do something different today, and that is audience participation. So take out your cell phones, and even if you maybe are not as technically advanced, perhaps you don't have a smartphone, that's okay. Or if you have your iPad or a mini iPad, please take them out. So everyone take out your phones. I really mean this, because this is an audience participation. So this convocation address is not simply me talking at you, but I want to find out a little bit more about the campus, okay? All right, so now that you have your phones out, all right, so you heard Christina, when you first entered, say that you can. The quickest way to do this in real time is to download the Poll Everywhere app. So if you go to your Play Store, here's the picture, right? Here's the Apple App Store, here's the Google Play, and then you can download Poll Everywhere. And if you do that, it's really easy, because then as I click on the questions for you to answer, it will come up automatically on your phone, all right? So, if you don't do it that way, there's another way to do it. How many of you know how to text? If you have children, you know how to text. If you're my age or older, maybe you don't know how to text. But you can also vote via texting, right? So here's where you, if the question is, what's your favorite color? You can text in, if you've red is your favorite color, you text in 331432, and so forth. It's not working yet, so hold on. This is just to run you through. And this is how you can vote online. If you want to open your internet browser, you can do that as well. And you have to go to what you have to type in pollevcom.com/presjunn, and that will open up into this Poll Everywhere voting period. Okay. All right, so here's the test question. So let's just do a test, see if it's working. Put in, what is your favorite color? You can text in. Remember, you can go to the online where you go to Prez Junn, or you can text to Prez Junn. And let's see, you can see in real time then what everybody's responses is. I believe if you're watching this live, your votes are actually continuing to go also in. So this includes people who are not even in this room, because it's all live on the internet. Okay, so let's see what this audience's favorite color is. So far, blue is out in the lead. Purple is a close second. Red is close behind that in third. Yellow is not, orange is not doing too well here either. Okay, green is pulling up. Purple's going higher. Oh, wow, look, purple's, blue is still in the lead, but just by a hair. All right, we're gonna go for another 15 seconds and then we'll close the poll, hold on. So blue is still in the lead, but purple's just, oh no, look at this, okay. Okay, blue's back in the lead. All right, and blue's still there. All right, so Louise, oh, it's a tie. Nope, there we go, blue pulls up ahead again. All right. In 5 seconds, we're gonna close the poll. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Louise, close the poll. Look at that, purple wins. All right, so this gives you a sense of how you can use the system, right? It's live, and you can see your votes come in as we speak. And part of the reason for doing this is, as a newcomer to Stan State, I kind of want to know. I'm really interested in understanding who's in the audience and what you're thinking. So we have a few of these questions here at the beginning. All right, so that was a test question. What's your favorite color? So purple pulled out ahead, blue's second, red's third, green, and then yellow and orange. All right, so the next question is, I'm not sure why this is, okay, but this is, who are you? And so we're assuming if you're on campus, then you could be a faculty member, as a staff person, a student, administrator. If you're a community member, you would choose text in E. If you're other, like media, for example, you could text in F. Okay. So please put in your votes. So we have 170 respondents, so more than half of the people in the room this morning are staff. So thank you so much for being here this morning. Okay, next question. If you're an employee, tell us, text in, how many years you've been here at Stan State. So we'll get a sense of how many people have been here less than a year, 1 to 5 years, 5 to 15, or 15 to 30, or 30 or more. So far, nobody's done, or maybe someone who's in this age bracket doesn't know how to text. That's okay. It's a new technology. It is something that we all have to learn, right? I didn't know how to text until my son went to college. And then I learned, because he responds to text more than he does to email, right? Okay, so we have 168 people who've responded. And look at this. So the majority of people in the audience today are generally either 1 to 5 or 5 to 15 years. So we do have 1% here 30 years or more. So bravo for some of our longstanding. No, it's a good thing. Yay, you're shaking, you're saying yes. Okay, we have 172 who's input their data, 773. All right, so Louise, let's close the poll. We're up to 176. Okay, more and more of you are learning how to do this. 176 now, very good. Okay, excellent. So the vast majority of people here are between 5 and 15 years in that age range, number of years and so forth. Okay, so excellent. But 12% in the audience have only been here less than a year. So great. Okay, next question. Is where are you from? Where is your birthplace? So if you're from the Central Valley, you say A, and then Southern Cal is B, Northern Cal, a state near California is D, the Midwest, the South, East Coast, or not from the United States. And now we can see the actual numbers of people. This is the head count here instead of percentage. So look at this, 163 people have responded so far. All right. So 182, excellent. 183. So very good. So let's, Luis, in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, let's close the polls. All right, so what does this tell you? It tells us that most of us here on our campus who are working employees are from Central Valley. Not too surprising, that's outstanding. So that means that you really understand and grew up and love this region of the state. So it's an incredibly important region of the state. And then a smaller proportion from Northern Cal, and then Southern Cal and Midwest are sort of about the same. Not from the United States, 20 people who are international. That's fantastic. Okay, so that gives me a sense of who is in the audience, and it gives you a sense of who our campus employees are. All right, so let's move on. Now here, this is a little different. Now you have to type in. So you don't type in letters, A, B, C, D, E, F. Now you type in a word. So what I'm asking you here is we're gonna use that technology item that says, just choose one word and type in the one word, and you type in, again, online here, or you can text. You first text to this number, and type in the one word that you think best describes our campus. What's the one word that best describes? Now, obviously, what you see here is that the more people who text the same word, the bigger that word will become. Do you see how that works? This is really cool how technology does this, right? So type in the words that you want. Just one word per person. And you can see it actually changed. So look at this, 130 of you, 134 now are typing in. And our picture is growing. So 179, 180, 181. 182. Now some of you may not be, let's see, maybe there's some spelling errors here. I saw like a growing on flick, not sure what that means. Gnarly, here's gnarly. Here's dude, okay. Fleek, I don't know what fleek means. All right, so wow, look at this, we're up to 222 responses. That's fantastic. Okay, so in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, Luis, you can close the poll. All right, so what do we see here with 228 people responding? What's the biggest word with the most responses is community. And then the next largest ones are what else? Home. Diverse, beautiful, family, growing. Then we have friendly, awesome. What does fleek mean? It does show up as fairly large. Does that mean something? What does it mean? Oh, it means, okay. All right, I gotta get hip to the new lingo here. And what about, is growing? That's not a word. And oh, look, here's our ducks. No one wrote about the cats. What about our cats? Oh no, look at down here, retirement. All right, so this is actually a really important exercise for me because as we think about where the campus is going, part of the new president's job is to listen and to understand and then to act on that information. So I want to spend time to hear more about what the campus thinks about where we are, What are the challenges and where can we grow for the future? And I have lots of ideas which I'll share with you. Okay, so this is important also because we'll be starting to do a university strategic plan. And these words help inform that process. And you'll all be part of that process, as I'll explain in a moment. Okay, so this was, did you find this fun? It's kind of fun? Yeah, it's pretty cool. All right, so technology can be a very cool thing. All right, so let's go to the next slide. This slide says, where are we? We're, of course, at Stan State in this beautiful city called Turlock. It was actually incorporated officially in 1908. And when I came to this campus, I immediately felt that sense of community, and I'll explain some of that in a moment. Okay, so that was already then supported by what you all wrote. That was community is one of the most important features that you, special word that you used for Stan State. Okay, so part of the reason it's such a great campus is because we have outstanding faculty. So I just wanted to recognize that I'm a person who pays attention to data. And what I've noted is we're one of 23 campuses in the system. And every campus, of course, in the CSU has to have faculty. And there are faculty who are tenured, and we have 173. And then we also have 84 who are tenured track, for a total of 257 tenured and tenure track faculty, and then we have 319 lecturers, and lecturers are extremely important. That was my first job as a member of the, when I first came to California, I was a lecturer, full-time lecturer, at Cal State San Bernardino. So lecturers are also very important because they all teach our students, right? So we have a total of 576 faculty, and that means the tenure density is a metric that the Chancellor's Office uses, and it's nationally recognized as well. So last year, our tenure density, meaning the percent of tenured and tenure track faculty divided by the FTEF of the lectures, is 61, almost 62%. And guess what? The system-wide average is 55, and we are the second highest in the system. So that means we are very strong in the way that the campus believes that faculty are key to the success of our students, particularly PhD or terminally trained instructors in the classroom. Okay, so bravo. And as your president, I will continue to support the hiring of more faculty as funds become available. We want to grow, not just our departments, but new programs even is another possibility. So this is something we'll be talking about in the next 5 to 6, 7 years, 8 years now. Okay, so besides our great faculty, I wanted to especially introduce, we have new faculty who've joined the campus. There are 28 new faculty. Where are the new faculty? If you're here, can you please stand? We want to give you a round of applause. All the new faculty? Any new faculty here? Oh, they're all teaching. There's a few of them. Okay, very good. Bravo. So this is some of them. Here's some more. And then let's see, there are some that we don't have pictures for yet, right? But there are 28 new faculty, and they were introduced at the faculty meeting last week, and outstanding, incredible areas of research and scholarly creative activity. So students, you're gonna be so lucky to have these new faculty join you in the classroom. We have also the reason Stanislaus State is so great is we have incredibly talented, dedicated, hardworking staff. So here's just an example of some of the tours where I was meeting staff over the last couple months. And we have almost a similar number of faculty as we do staff on our campus. And that's a wonderful thing because you're all working hard to help students succeed. Okay. All right. So now that I know a little bit about who's in the audience and a little bit about you and where your birthplace is, you probably want to know a little bit more about me. Now you have read some of the stuff in the magazine or on the website, so I want to just spend a brief moment or so telling you a little bit about myself. Now if you came to my campus welcome, which was in July 7th, you would have heard a little bit more. But not everyone's heard that, so I promise this will be the last time I'll tell this story. But so when people ask me, where are you from? I'll say, I'm from Michigan. And then what you see here is a map of Jenison. Jenison is a small town on the western side of Michigan. And okay, where is it? This is actually very similar to Turlock. It was a farming town. It is not so much farming anymore, but it was mostly dairy and vegetables. That's an actual farm that existed. It's still, I don't know if it still exists today. in Jenison, and it's very nearby Holland, which is just a little bit north, and so it's very many people from the Netherlands there in that town. And because it was largely from the Netherlands, and it was a small farming town, when my family moved there, we were the only Asian family in the town. And so I will tell you that people would say, well, where are you from? And I'd say, well, I'm from Michigan. And they'd say, no, where are you really from? And, and I would say, well, I'm from Champaign. Champaign is a town in Illinois. In fact, the University of Illinois is there. My father was in graduate school at the time. And I said, I was born in Illinois. And they'd say, no, you speak English so beautifully. Where are you really from? And I'd say, well, I was born in America. I'm American. And they would say, no, really, where are you really from? So I started telling people this. Actually, I'm from Sweden. And I told people I was from Sweden because it seemed kind of silly, but it is so funny because coming to Turlock is like coming full circle. When I drive to Turlock, it reminds me so much of going back when I was in college, driving from Ann Arbor, where I was a student, to Jenison. The terrain is similar, the hospitality is same, the farming feeling is the same, so it's almost like coming home. And then when I did my research on Turlock, guess what? It was originally founded by who? My ancestors, the Swedes. So I am coming full circle back to Turlock and here to Stanislaus State. So it's exciting to be here. So as I said, I was born in the Midwest, raised primarily in Illinois, Michigan, and spent a few years in Georgia. I have attended state and private institutions, both public as well as elite. As you've heard, one of the main things for me is in my professional career, I've always tried to put front and center academic student support, programs for faculty, academic technology, legislative advocacies. These are all things I have done in the past and will continue to do to move us forward here at Stanislaus State. So, as I said, coming back to the Central Valley is really like coming home, but it's even more amazing because we have an incredible campus that has earned many recognitions recently, and still more to come, and we will do that together. All right, so I have very, very deep fundamental beliefs about diversity and inclusion. Obviously, growing up in the 60s in America during a time of turbulence and social change and social justice was very informing of my personal beliefs, and will continue to support that diversity on campus and in the region. And as you've heard, this is my 31st year in the CSU. So it is something that is important to me to take what I've learned and with all the people that have supported me in all the different other campuses I've been to really make a difference here and to listen and work with everyone on campus. And as you probably heard, I'm not a formal person, so it is strange to me when people say President Junn, because I never started off thinking I'd want to be a president. I do prefer if you just call me Ellen. But as you'll see, I've met so many people that I'm not sure if I can ever remember everyone's name or face. So if you see me on campus, please come up and introduce yourself so I can get more practice knowing who you are and getting your names and faces together. Okay, so that's enough about me. Now, who is this person? It's someone who is Franklin D. Roosevelt. Okay, and this, he is attributed with coining the term first 100 days. Do you know the story behind this? Some of you do, some of you are history majors or political scientists, right? So this term was actually coined back in July 24th, way back in 1933, and it was a radio address that FDR was giving, and he was actually referring to the 100 days session of Congress, not actually how many days he'd been in office, but of Congress, right? So, but it's a term that lives on today, and people will often say, so what have you done in the first 100 days, right? And that's a fair question. So you might ask, how many days have I been here? Today is my 60th day, all right? Out of the 100, it's my actual 60th day. I started on July 1. So I want to give you a quick update on the kinds of things that I've been doing. So some of you have a sense of, what kind of activities. So here are some of the accomplishments. First off, I want to tell you that I have like at least five core principles that I think is really important. And these principles can vary and change as I find out what the campus and the faculty and staff and students think about as well. But in general, I think our campus is so important because we are going to be the transformational agent for our students in our region. And so we want to continue to improve student success. And the one way to do that is by supporting faculty and staff in their efforts on campus, right? So it's extremely important that we pay a lot of attention to our faculty and staff and provide them with resources and opportunities to go on and work with our students. In addition, as a president, you have to pay attention to the entire university. That is the infrastructure as well as all the VPs and all the different divisions. And very, very important, and that's why I wanted to highlight our community members, our elected officials, our superintendents, and so forth, because they are so critical in forming the whole ecosystem that will drive the success of our students, of our neighborhoods, and our communities. So partnerships with the community is absolutely critical. And then the fifth thing is, don't forget, we need to celebrate, we need to recognize, and have some fun in doing this as well. Okay. All right, so here's an update on some of the activities. And I tried to do this in collage form. So we arrived just a little bit before July 1st, and then we lived in a hotel for a while until the house came open. And so here's the moving truck. Here's, the horrors of moving, right? I'm still not sure where some of the things are in boxes. Here I am in the bookstore buying some swag. You gotta wear some Stanislaus shirts and jackets and so on. This was a funny thing. I don't know if you saw this. Raise your hand if you saw this. Almost all of you saw this. This is funny. I did not know that there was a billboard with my face on it. I don't necessarily want to be in the front and center in the spotlight, so I didn't know about this until the July 7th welcome, my welcome to the community, and there are about 200 people showed up and everyone's shaking my hand, so different people come in and they say, so nice to meet you, you look exactly like the picture on the billboard, and I went, billboard? Me? Taking a mental note, and I'm thinking, where is this billboard? I didn't see it. I didn't see it for probably 2 weeks, because I was coming in from the hotel that is up by the mall there, the opposite direction, so I never saw the billboard. It wasn't until we moved into this, now it's not quite this messy, into the home that, and it's the same home that President Chile lived in as well, that I finally saw this billboard and I went, oh my gosh. So now the terrible thing is, since there aren't too many Asians here in Turlock, sort of like where I grew up, now that my face has been on this billboard, I can't go incognito anywhere. So I have to make sure I look reasonably decent when I'm on a weekend. And, should I put makeup on and to go out and get my groceries, Because I'll go in and get my hair done and someone will say, you look familiar. I know I've seen your face somewhere. So that's the consequence of being a president. But it is still, I did ask them to take the billboard down, so it's no longer there. But it was a nice thought, a nice gesture, so I appreciate it. And then here I am on the first day that I arrived, I made phone calls to some of our transformational donors. So the donors who've donated significant, very large sums of money to the campus, I called them and said, thank you so much for supporting our campus and our students. So that was me taking some photographs. This is not my office, but it's not that messy. This is my inbox in my email. So this is just to let you know, if I try very hard to respond to people within 24 to 48 hours, but obviously as a new incoming president, there's a lot of email. And so if I don't answer right away, just understand that I'll get to you. It'll just take a little bit more time. All right, so what are the things, some of the notable events? I think this one was one of the most fun, is I didn't realize until I got here that there was a Turlock 4th of July parade. I'd already heard about the fireworks. President Sheely had worked with a group to help support the fireworks on campus by the FDC. In fact, this is, if you've never seen what fireworks look like before they go off, this is what it looks like. That's the actual picture here. These are the cannons where they shoot them from. And so when I heard that there was a parade, I simply said to our advancement folks, I said, is the president expected to go? Is there a role for the president? And they said, well, let's go and check. We'll get back to you. And the next thing I know, they show up with this giant banner, and there is a bidding war about whose truck am I going to ride in. And so here is Mayor Gary Soises. So we rode in his truck. This is his truck. His parents are driving. His nieces and nephews are sitting in the back. And look at this. I was stunned. I remember parades like this when I was growing up in Michigan. And it was like, you know, deja vu, thinking back to childhood. It was so fabulous to see the whole community turned out for the fireworks and for the parade. It was just such a wonderful, warm welcoming on only 3 days after I arrived. So that was very fun. Here was the welcome reception, July 7th, so meeting the 200 people. This is my husband, Alan. If you know him, he's very unpredictable. You never know what he's going to say, so I'm always afraid to give him the mic. He's a retired physicist. And then, let's see, a little bit more here. Okay, so some of the things on events on campus that I participated in, the lagomorph, if you don't know what that means, it's the study of rabbits, and I learned all about pikas. It was very cool. I'm a scientist, an empirical scientist by nature, so I was very interested to hear about, this was the fifth world conference, and it was hosted on our campus, and the first time in the United States, so we were very proud to have that hosted here. Okay, I spent an entire day visiting the Stockton Center, actually met Congressman McGurney and other elected officials showed up. We had various different, met with Sandy and Kevin Huber, who work with the groupie found the corporation that manages the Stockton Center, as well as meeting this fabulous class of nursing students. And here's Dean Famous Harrison. He's an extremely important individual who's going to really take Stockton to the next level. So it's very exciting to have spent that time, that day there. Okay, next picture. Been out and about in the community. So here we are trying to celebrate the arts. We did the sciences, but we also do the arts. So here's, I don't know if you know, these are two alumni who live in LA, Robert and Kim Ulrich. She's a noted actress. He was the producer for Glee. If you, very, very famous, you know, the television show. And then, let's see, a number, this is the Carnegie, right here, the Carnegie Art Center, where Dean DeCoker was also working, and John Mayer also in his role. Okay, so here, almost every night, it seems like I have an event. Here we are kicking off the One Purpose Scholarship Campaign. Have been still called to Long Beach frequently for the Board of Trustees or for the President's Council. Here I am visiting the amazing staff, in this case it's the Provost Office. And I also went on a retreat, it was somewhere in Tuolumne, somewhere out there. You didn't even have Google Maps, it was kind of scary. but it was a beautiful location. I met with the students, and we're so cool here because at Stanislaus State, our ASI board and the student union board meet together for their annual summer retreat, and it was so much fun. We had a chance to sit and talk about issues that students were particularly interested in. Okay, so that was that meeting. Here again is more meetings. Here's Maggie White. Is Maggie here? There's Maggie. She's our CSU student trustee, very important. Only one student a year is elected as a voting member, and Maggie is that. And it's appointed. It's actually appointed. Are you also appointed by the governor, too? Yep. So the governor appoints all the trustees, of which are about 22, I think, and it's confirmed by the Senate. So we are so fortunate that a Stan State student is representing us on the Board of Trustees, and that is Maggie. So thank you, Maggie. And here's Nicole. You heard from Nicole. She had a beautiful speech. Thank you, Nicole, as our ASI student body president. And this are pictures of, I asked that my cabinet to come out with me on the first day that the freshmen were arriving to greet the parents and the students and say hello. And so you can see we had the largest number of students ever who have moved into the dorms I think it was 712, is that right, Suzanne? Something, 725, something like that. The largest number ever moving into the dorms, and so it was really great fun. As you can see here, I'm trying to learn how to tweet, so you'll see more about that. So what else? Here are the accomplishments. Those are some of the events, but here are some of the accomplishments. I have met, and actually Amanda's been trying to keep track of all the people I've been meeting, over 675 people. 230 or so are following me on Twitter. So if you want to try to follow me, you can go at Prez Junn is how you follow. So we can make this number bigger next time, right? And isn't that supposed to be the cool thing? You have to have a lot of followers, right? So like I said, when I see you on campus, if I have a blank look in my eye, there are too many names and faces to remember right now. So that's why I said, I encourage you to come up and say hello, shake my hand and say, I'm so-and-so and I work in such and such place, okay? I am so pleased. I've had meetings with the Senate leadership and the Senate executive members. If you're Senate faculty, would you please stand? I want to give a special round of applause to all of our faculty senators. Please stand. There we go. Excellent. And together we're going to craft an important document that shows our joint commitment to shared governance and communication and collaboration. So the Senate exec is working on that as we speak. We've talked about holding some joint retreats between the cabinet and the Senate, and which to also sponsor some university-wide symposia on critical issues in higher ed or critical issues that are affecting our campus in particular or California as well. I also have had a chance to meet with the union leadership, the Labor Council. And if you're with Labor Council, could you please stand up? I want to thank the staff Labor Council members. Bravo. Excellent. So we are going to have regular meetings to talk and discuss issues because we want to understand if there are problems or issues so we can begin to solve them. So that will continue with regular meetings and activities. And as I mentioned to you before, sorry, just kidding. Tangled here. In an effort to try and systematically create an opportunity to do listening tour, I've created a presidential transition team. And so what this is these individuals. So if you're on the I know it's really tiny, but those of you who are on the team, you know who you are, you've been asked and appointed. So if those on the presidential team, can you please stand and get our recognition? All those on the presidential team, please stand. Thank you. It's going to be co-chaired by Martin and Kilolo, Martin Gunn and Kilolo Brody. And really what it is an organized attempt where the team will go out and conduct 15 facilitated forums. So for example, three for faculty, three for students, three for staff, et cetera. And the whole purpose of this is to get feedback on some of the critical issues as we think about planning for a university strategic plan. And it's just like here in the Scrabble, what we're trying to do is to listen, and then understand, and then act, right? So that's sort of the three-step process. And if you don't have time to come to a forum, we will have a web-based opportunity for you to send in information as well, okay? So that's the presidential transition team. In addition, we're now going to work on a new university strategic plan. So this one is, we're thinking tentatively of making it go to 2025. That's the year in which the Chancellor's Office has set goals for all 23 campuses. So that's 8 years from now, but that's a nice round number to work with. And so we're beginning to work on this university strategic plan with the Senate. And here are the members of the strategic plan. It'll be co-chaired by the provost and Stuart Sims as Speaker of the Senate. So please stand if you're part of the university strategic plan. Please stand and be recognized. Excellent. All right. Sorry. And this, I don't know if you've seen pictures of this, but this is an aerial photograph of, guess who these are? These are all of our freshmen. And this, I want to tell you, this is the largest class of freshmen that Stanislaus State has ever had in the history, in the 59-year history of our campus. So it was very fortuitous that we were able to do, for the very first time in over 10 years, a special freshman convocation for the freshmen to welcome them. And so if you had this on your phone, you can zoom it up and you can see each individual student standing there. Over 900 students were photographed in this picture. All right, so the point of the having the freshman convocation is to support students from the very first day. So they had 900 freshmen or so were attending. They get a chance to meet with all of the faculty, the key administrators, and get to know one another and learn about the resources for the university. And the goal is to help freshmen understand, in order to finish in 4 years, you have to take 15 units to finish, right? So we're trying to help students understand what it means if they want to try and finish in 4 years. So students wanted to take pictures. I did finally learn how to do a selfie. So here's me doing a selfie with the students. I asked them to take a picture of themselves and to save it, and then look at themselves 4 years later to remember where they were on that first day of their freshman year. Now, the reason this is especially important is it was just announced. In fact, last night, I got an email from the chancellor's office about the legislature's interest, the governor's interest in particular, for moving the four-year graduation rate. So what we have received, all presidents in the system of the CSU, we now have six goals to achieve. And the ones in red are the ones that they're focusing on, so that we, as a campus, have to increase our four-year rate for freshmen, our two-year transfer rate, and our achievement gaps, whether you're underrepresented or whether you get financial aid, Pell gap. And the system wants all campuses to close the gap to zero, eliminate the achievement gap. But as you can see here, this is our current numbers, and we have to increase it, like triple it in this case, and then increase by 12 percentage points here. But we have until 2025. So we have some work to do. And so I met yesterday with the deans and some of the key AVPs and student affairs, and we're going to move ahead on some interesting ideas about how to further support our students. Now, it's one thing to say, the legislature to say, go out and do this. It's another thing if we don't have the money. So here's the cool thing. So these are some ideas that we're contemplating, right? So we're going to talk about how we can focus on freshmen to get them out, so to prepare them. So that's freshman convocation. We were thinking about other kinds of programs. Here we go. Accelerate for the summer, a dream seminar possibility, expand summer bridge. These are all options. And then obviously working with community colleges in terms of transfer pathways and the K-12 as well. And the nice thing is, last night from the chancellor's office, I got an email saying, President Junn at Stanislaus State, the legislature is awarding you how much? $1 million. That sounds like a lot of money. But what's the problem here? What does it say? One time. So our goal here is to try and move our graduation rates after 1 year to see, to then tell the legislature and the governor, look, with $1 million, we were able to do this. And with that, we hope to ask for additional funding that would be sustainable in the future, because we're going to take a focused look at how to help increase our student success. And this is coming from the legislature, from the Board of Trustees, and the public as well. Okay. Next. All right, so ideas for the future. We're running out of time, so what I want to do is just, I'm not going to go through each one, but this will all be available on the website, and you can download it or watch it. The PowerPoint will be there statically, but you can also watch the video. But I've sort of categorized into four different buckets, if you will, some ideas about how we can meet our goals and increase our visibility and success. So obviously things like we want to focus on students and graduation. There are at least five things that we could do here. I've told the students, for example, we have to restore the Career Development Center, right? We find ways to help support student writing, look carefully at the reports that already exist and figure out which elements are ones that we can pull out and increase, scale up. We might do other things to attract really the best and brightest, for example, presidential scholars. Faculty, as I told you, is so important. So one of the things we can do there is to help provide resources for faculty who are engaged in high impact practices, things like whether they're using service learning or internships, whether they do undergraduate research. All of those have been shown to significantly improve students' connection with their university and to feel satisfied and stay in school and graduate. I want to be able to find funds to increase scholarly research, creative, and grant activity for the faculty, as well as things like supporting innovations, teaching and learning, which you already have in part with the FDC, curricular and program innovations, and a lot for staff as well. So we want to help figure out ways to use technology to reduce the workload, identify areas where there maybe are efficiencies we can improve on, build more collaborations, have more recognition of faculty and staff doing good things, enhancing community building, collegial opportunities, communication. And one thing that I hope to do in the future is to commission a presidential commission for diversity and inclusion that will be charged to write an institutional diversity plan, which is a pretty big ticket item. It takes some time to do that, but I think it's important. And to focus on quality and service in everything we do. And as I said, the community is extremely critical here. So we need to continue to build these strong partnerships, which have already started with our business, civic, government, artistic, nonprofit leaders. We want to continue to forge good relationships with donors, alumni, and other organizations, and do a robust marketing campaign to highlight our strengths. So here's just an example. I'm calling it DYK, Did You Know? All right. So there's a lot of people don't know about Stanislaus, and so what we want to do is to get the word out, right? So how do you get the word out? Well, first thing you have to do is you have to know what are the facts that are interesting. So I'm not going to read these. You can find them on the website later. But just as one example of what a did you know is that 100%, if you're a nurse at the Stockton Center, if you're a nursing student, 100% in the last 4 years actually got a job in the first 6 months of graduating. 100%, right? These are things that we don't necessarily hear unless we publicize it. So that's why I've said, here's some more examples, that what you need to do is send your did you know facts to Amanda, and we will start tallying them up and begin to promote that. It will be in my signature line, and we'll promote that in various news releases and stories and so forth, okay? All right, so the summary is the following. So what I first want to just say is we want to honor our history of our past and current achievements. We want to maximize our students' success, align our budgets to support that. It's so important that we collaborate and communicate with each other, that we will work on this through the strategic planning process and focus on accreditation with WASC, which is coming down the pike in another year and a half. But I do want to stress that I want to encourage people to be innovative and creative, to pay attention to results, and to have some fun. So these are all things that we want to do as a summary. Before I close, I wanted to show you an important video. I don't know, have any of you seen this love letter to Stanislaus? Raise your hand if you have. Just a few of you. So it's a little bit, I think it's about 3.5 minutes long, but I want to show it to you because it was actually created with the Stanislaus Community Foundation. Marion Cannon is the executive director, and Ben Hoover, who was the videographer, is actually one of our alums. Now, so watch this video, and there are just a few places that you'll see Stanislaus. Okay, so please turn it on.
Dear Stanislaus, when people see you from across a crowded freeway, smoke swirling from factory chimneys, the rusty bones of old automobiles stacked in scrap yards, mounds of fertilizer and cows gnawing on their hay, it is not love at first sight, or even second. Get out while you can, they say, before the summer sun smothers you, before the fog of winter hangs itself like ghosts in the almond trees. But we are not afraid of you, Stanislaus. We see the beauty in your bare branches that sprout white blossoms in the spring and feed us by the fall. We hear your symphony of sounds echoing in the alleyways downtown, opera, mariachi, jazz, hip hop. We dance under your blood orange moon, hipsters and homeless, farmers and suits. We eat carne asada at your taco trucks, drink Cabernet from your fields of wine, sleep in the foothills under the Sierra's diamond-studded sky. In the morning, you offer us cappuccinos, carve a smile into the thick foam, and call our names as if we have been friends our whole lives. You bake us bread, and we break it with neighbors in need, black and white, left or right. We know how to eat at the same table, even if we taste with different tongues. Your poetry is awakening, etching light into dark nights as we rise to watch your plays and ballets that bring tears to eyes that once only saw shame in you, Stanislaus, but now they see change in you. You are growing. You are pushing through like seeds beneath hard pan soil. You are shattering every stereotype heaped upon your back, but you worry that you are not strong enough to stand tall on your own. We hear you, Stanislaus, crying out for help in your plain-spoken English, in your Spanish, in the thick accent of your Assyrian mothers and Portuguese grandfathers, and we are listening. We are working in your schools, dusting the cobwebs off young minds, showing them that they can find hope in the pages of great books. We are sweeping your streets for parades on the 4th of July. We are weeding your trails, painting murals on your face to cover the wrinkles of time. We are cleaning your rivers, pruning mistletoe from magnolia trees, building bridges made of hope that arc toward a better tomorrow. You do not have to cry anymore, Stanislaus. Today, we choose to stay by your side because you are family. You taught us as children how to crawl with soil between our toes, and now it's time for us to teach others how to stand up for you in cowboy boots or Buster Browns in high heels or leather Oxfords or on bare, calloused feet. We will learn to walk taller along your great valley floor because we are all Stanislaus, and we are proud to call you home.
So I think that video captured something very beautiful about our county. And now we are Stanislaus State. So we are going to make, we're on the cusp of something big. I think we, as together, working together with our regional and local partners, we can go much further than we're, even where we are from today. We have already come very far. We've won some national awards. And this is just the beginning of something big. So before I close, I want you to take out your phones and do one last thing. And this is what I'm talking about here. I want to have us to work hard, dream big. That we want us to think creatively. And sometimes being creative does take some courage. But striving for success without hard work is like trying to harvest where you haven't planted. And working hard for something we care about is called stress. But working hard for something we love is called passion. And that's what I feel from so many of you, even in the short time that I've been here on campus. And remember, we always have to have fun in doing this. So take out your phones. And I want you to ask this final question. So I want to know, are you excited and ready to roll up your sleeves and get started on making Stanislaus State an even more visible, distinctive, and outstanding campus? And I want you to log in your vote on a scale of 1 to 5, 5 being excited, and so forth. And it's okay. This is all right. No campus, every campus has to have a few curmudgeons, so I'm expecting that. You can be honest. It's all anonymous. And this is the beginning of the fall semester as we think about going into our, creating our university plan. Where do we want Stanislaus to be in 5 to 8 years from now? What will we look like? How will we partner with our region? How can we grow as we continue to see migrations from the south, from the northern, the Bay Area down south? What can we do? How can we harness and use our passions to inform and transform our students, our campus, our region together? I know we can do it. So look at this. We have 167 people have voted in. And that's okay, as I said, 1% is not bad. but that's good, because having a diversity of opinion is always important, particularly in a democracy like America. So let's see, in 5, 4, 3, we'll close it. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Luis, you can close the thing. And look at this. So we have 70, almost three quarters are said you're excited. At least 23 said mildly excited. So this is great news, a great way to start the fall semester. So thank you again. This is going to be a great fall and a great 8 years as we plan for 2025. Thank you for coming and have a wonderful year.